Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. We're back again with episode 5 in our DevOps Dojo series. We're going to be talking about culture and mindset in this week's episode, so tune in. Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. We're back again with another DevOps Dojo episode. This time we're back with episode 5, focusing on culture and mindset. And with that, we have two amazing guests, Beste, Altinay, and Reggie Best. Welcome to you both.
Thank you. Welcome.
Glad to have you here. Beste, can you tell them what it is you do for Microsoft and how you got involved in the DevOps Dojo program?
I'm an architect at Microsoft now almost 10 years, and I have been part of the DevOps Dojo family from the beginning, 3 years now, and I'm really passionate about DevOps and what it can do in the organizations.
Awesome. Thank you. Now, Reggie, what do you do at Microsoft, and how did you get involved with the Dojo program?
I'm currently with the Office of the CTO and really, really excited about being part of DevOps Dojo. I had a chance to attend one of the classes while I was in Singapore, and it was so amazing, so exciting that I just wanted to be involved. They gave me an opportunity to get involved, and I've continued all the way through my journey into the US. So I'm really excited about being a part of it.
Awesome. Well, I'm excited to have both of you here. The DevOps Dojo series has been an amazing series with so much information and fantastic guests. So let's get started. Beste, you're going to sit there and you're going to tell us about culture. Can you tell us what is culture? How do we define it?
Yeah, in the classes, we use the official description from Ron Bestrom, and he's a sociologist. But there are some hard words in it. I'm going to keep it simple. You can think about it as the operating system in an organization. You don't see it, but it touches everything. Mm-hmm. And it determines everything, like what is acceptable, what is not, what to wear, what not to wear, how long the lunch break might take. But it also determines very important things like who to hire, who to fire, and who to promote.
Awesome. So really, why is culture important?
We always start in the class with this why part, and we give examples from aviation. And for that, we use the book of Malcolm Gladwell. In the book Outliers, he looks at the success, factors of success. And he gives examples from aviation. One of them is the Korean flight. In 1997, flying from Seoul to Guam, and they experienced some bad weather conditions, that there's low visibility. And so they decide to use the instrumental landing system. And that's a system that the plane sends a signal and the runway sends a signal, and then the landing is easier. The system from the runway was out of service, and the co-pilot notices this, and the pilot doesn't. But he just got a signal, and the investigation shows it was just an irrelevant electronic device somewhere giving that signal. So the co-pilot notices because they are descending steeply, and there is no airport in sight. You see his panic, but he doesn't speak up. So they land, and 254 people die. And the investigation shows that because of the culture, the Korean culture is a very high power distance culture. That means there's a strict hierarchy, and you, as subordinates, you don't question the opinions of the higher ranks. So the co-pilot doesn't dare to say anything, and it causes the death of 254 people. So it was a cultural issue. And the Korean Airlines, they started a trainings program just to create equality on board, assertiveness, and change this culture, at least on board. And then this accident didn't happen anymore. So when we start the classes with such an example, where cultural issues have killed hundreds of people, then you have the people listening why culture is important.
Gotcha. And when you were looking in within the DevOps Dojo team and working with DevOps transformation, what did you find was the biggest blocker in talking about and addressing the culture changes?
I even have a slide with this question, what is the blocker in DevOps? And it's culture. And Donner and Brown has a beautiful definition of the of DevOps, and he says it's the combination of people, process, and products. And it starts with people. And what I've seen in many customers where I've been to, it's always, they always start with the technology part, the product part, because it is very tangible. And you can think about it like an iceberg. And the top part above water, that's the process and the technology, because you see it, you can start implementing it immediately. And the bigger part under the water, that's the people part. And it's always being postponed. Let's start with this. Let's implement Azure DevOps, and then we will see how it goes. So the organizations that don't understand the importance of culture and don't concentrate on the people part, they're actually doomed to fail in their DevOps transformations.
I agree, and we see it so much with customers because we think we can buy this piece of software that will make this thing happen, and it doesn't work, and it doesn't enable us. And the culture is the hardest change in DevOps. Thank you, Beth. But really appreciate that. It was some great insight into culture. Reggie, you're going to talk to us about mindset. So take it away, please.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to talk to you. One of the biggest things that we find in any organization when you bring around culture is also how you deal with conflict. And one of the things that we found in dealing with conflict is you really have to have the right mindset in order to be able to work with everyone so that we can move the organization along quickly. And we use a model that I'll show to you in this diagram that presents five different areas that we focus in on. As you can see on the left, there's a focus around assertiveness and how people approach that when you're trying to get conflict resolved. And this conflict resolution model also shows how there's an approach around cooperativeness. And each one of these approaches are good to use in how we deal with conflict. I'm going to talk a little bit in the next few minutes about how we apply all of these different things, avoiding, accommodating, compromising, competing, and collaborating in our solution set as we deliver DevOps today. You'll find when you look at this, you'll say, well, how does an organization apply avoiding a strategy when they're trying to get everyone to work together? You'll find that these different strategies are effective when you're trying to solve different problems. For example, we use an avoiding strategy when it conflicts with one of our basic laws. We use a law around Conway's law, which says an organization that designs a system using a broad definition for system will produce a design whose structure is a copy of the organization's communication structure. So we're saying that our communication structure is very critical to us. We want to be able to have a collaborative and open a discussion around different things. And so when we find that someone brings up an issue and we find conflict that's going to violate one of our laws, we'll apply an avoiding strategy. So that means that we will try to avoid that subject and not focus on it. For example, how can we apply an accommodating approach or an accommodating strategy? When we're finding that when we're having these discussions and dialogues, you'll find that there are different conflicts that come up within a team. And as you know, a DevOps team is a DevOps community is really a team of people working together to try to solve the complex issues around DevOps. And when we're doing that, you'll find that sometimes you have confirmation bias, a way of thinking or a way of believing that your solution is the right solution simply because you ignore all the other options. And so we find that we'll apply an accommodating approach when we find that we need to at least collaborate and try to integrate two different ideas. So in our case, we had two different ways or three different ways of delivering our class, and our class involved being able to deliver it over 10 days. And so we found that when we started to look at the different ways of doing it, some parts of the world wanted to deliver that class in 5 days, in full day classes over 5 days. Some of our people wanted to deliver the class in half day classes over 10 days, which is our traditional approach. And some people wanted to combine both GitHub and ADO in both sessions and deliver it over 10 days, 10 full day sessions. So we found that through our approach of accommodating each one of these different solutions and A/B testing, we found that the best way to do it allowed us to deliver it remotely and deliver it in half day classes. So that gives you an example of how we're accommodating to different ideas within our team. We also have the approach what comes up around how you would apply a compromising strategy. So a compromising strategy says you're going to involve an acceptable solution that really satisfies one party. The concerns of not all the parties might be resolved, but it leaves out some of the benefits from each one of the parties so that everybody shares in the solution. And so that solution, you'll find we described it in our experimental learning slides and our blog about how we applied that same learning approach and how you'll get insight from working with different people. Again, we're applying these different strategies within our working team to allow us to remove conflict and to move our goals forward. The goal in this case is we wanted to be able to apply a self-study approach so that people can allow themselves to learn the equipment quickly without spending a lot of time, or whether they wanted to actually go through an immersive program, which took a lot of time out of their day. And again, we had to figure out how we can do that so that everybody wins, so that we get the best of all the ideas and that we can resolve the conflicts quickly. That approach, and when we're using compromising, it didn't give us everybody's idea, but it allowed us all to have a piece of the idea. Then the last two pieces I'll talk about is competing. In a competing approach, you have to satisfy just one person's opinion and not everyone's. And that one we use very rarely when it's an emergency and we have to really be aggressive on how we solve something. We'll jump to a competing approach because that allows us to quickly get to an answer and move past the conflict. Finally, we talk about collaboration, which is our most important way that we try to deal with it. We try to collaborate on so many different things and work together as a team to solve conflict so that we can come up with the best ideas. And that's what DevOps is all about, trying to find the best ideas and collaborating quickly.
I love that, Reggie. I think you've brought up some great points here with compromising being in the middle. And I think for all the developers out there and all the teams embracing DevOps, we've all seen these personality traits come out when working in a team and that culture change is happening. And any one of these in their extremes is not good. So it's coming in and bringing a part of it, piece of all those together to make that piece whole. And I've been in teams where there's too much accommodating and nothing gets done because no one makes a decision. And I've been in teams where everyone's competing for their best answer. And then it's just anger. So, you know, going to the extremes, we've all experienced it. So Reggie, thank you so much. Beste, thank you so much. And for everyone that's tuning in today, we're going to put a link in the show notes for the episode 5 of the DevOps Dojo blog that you can check out and read about all these details in depth. So everyone, thank you for tuning in and join us next time. We're going to have another episode from the DevOps Dojo team.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening.